Brazil. A little bit more than 200 million people. First country in terms of online time spent online, So Brazilians really, really like to browse and navigate online and interact in social networks, right? We have around 10 million users on broadband, and a bunch of other figures that you can see there, which I'm not going to keep saying. But basically, out of those 200 million people, half of them are online. And the other half is really poor. So we are talking about, and I'll show you a little bit more, a comparison between Brazil and UK in terms of salary distributed on the population. And you see that we have a bunch of people that's really poor. And that creates a difference in social class, what we call the socioeconomic class grade, which is unlike India, for instance, who has castas, but nobody is divided in castas, but you have people that are in different social class, socioeconomic classes, and you can tell just by looking at them, the way they dress, how they behave, how they speak. So it's clear the ones that are non-educated and the ones that are educated, right? And there is a strong correlation on money. And that is the first challenge. So although the C class, which our middle class, is growing, we still don't have a middle class because these guys don't have purchase power. So you have lots of poor people, then you have a very, very small middle class, and then you have a lot of people with a lot of money, and a lot of money. Some billionaires are Brazilians, right? So despite that, the government are trying to do shifts on digital inclusion on the government, which is needed. Otherwise, they wouldn't have access at all. They just can't purchase that, and talk about half the population, right? And obviously, there was World Cup this year, not a pleasant subject to talk, so I won't. And hopefully, Olympics will be a little bit better in Brazil. So let's start to give you some comparisons. So here, we have GDP, right? Gross domestic product by country. And I put some countries here. I didn't put the US because it would be up there. Brazil is the seventh biggest economy in the world, very close to UK. We actually surpassed them 1 year, which was very well celebrated there, but now we're back here, especially because exchange rates. Russia, Italy are the following ones, and you can see how we have a stronger economy than Canada, for instance. Okay, so Brazil has a very strong economy, which has grown a lot in the last years. And that growth, which brought us here to there, surpassing a lot of countries, brought a lot of consequences to the country. One of them is the fertility rate. Check Brazil. This is really amazing, right? So we, in a matter of 25 years, fertility rate just dropped. Now, Brazilians started to have access to purchasing power, so they had to purchase. And they can't purchase to 10 kids, right? So they need to have 2 kids or 1 kid to be able to purchase things for them. So just by improving their economic situation, fertility rate dropped dramatically. But when you divide that per capita, right? Per the number of people, clearly Brazil is in a very different situation. So all that money, seventh largest economy in the world still does not, is not enough to account for the huge amount of people we have. And that's the shocking graph. So here I have UK, here I have Brazil, right? This is roughly 2.5 is the rate between dollar and reais. So divide this by 2.5, you would have $200 to $300, $350. 50% of the population lives on a monthly basis with $300, $350. It is really a poor people. And then you go to the next bracket and you have 80% of the population. Compare this to the UK and you can see that in UK you really have a middle class. In Brazil, here's the middle class. So this poses all kinds of challenges. Despite that, like I told you, we really like internet for some reason. And I would assume that one of the reasons is because we're very sociable people. So it's very common to everyone to have literally thousands of friends, whatever, Facebook, LinkedIn. You mention it, everyone has thousands of friends, right? I have 3,500 friends in LinkedIn, for instance. Just, we really like to talk. So, you can see that e-commerce is growing even in a stronger rate than our economy. So if our economy is growing, e-commerce is growing even more. And this is the total number of online shoppers. So we have 63 million people who will, in 2014, have bought at least once online. So this gives us the size of the UK population. Great, so let's talk about eHarmony. And I'll divide my talk in two parts. I'll quickly talk about eHarmony when I was invited to bring them to Brazil. Basically, I came over here in Pasadena, where was eHarmony headquarters. They have taken the decision to start operations in Brazil as the first non-English country for eHarmony international expansion. They hired me, I came here, learned the business, went back to Brazil, empty-handed, literally, and from scratch had to build a company, obviously with the support of eHarmony here. What was the scenario? The scenario was this. The category existed over 10 years already in Brazil. So they, par perfeito, which was acquired by Match.com, was already in Brazil at the time. This was 2010. So since 2000, there were incumbents in the market, right? And then all of the others started to pop out. And lots of small ones, very niche websites for Christians, Jews, you mentioned it, right? There are everything, and also these which were not exactly relationship, but they were there also, okay? It is some kind of relationship, right? Short-term, very short-term relationship. And so when I took the job, the first thing I want to know is what's going to be space in Brazil for a late entrant 10 years later? And so this was one of the first things I did. Where would eHarmony appear compared to the incumbents? And obviously eHarmony, which I'm sure most of you know, is about marriage, right? Long-term, serious relationship. You only go to eHarmony if you want to marry someone for the rest of your life. And that's its purpose, right? So it's a valid purpose. It was very... there wasn't some space here, right? And, well, it seems like a good idea. So here what happened. We went to Brazil. I went back to Brazil in August, I think. August 2010. Just after the website went live and I was here. So first challenge. Simple, isn't it? You just hire someone to translate the website and you put it on eharmony.com.br. And that's it, right? It works. Well, first of all, they have chosen a company to translate who didn't have Brazilians on their staff for some reason. It was like an international translating company with people scattered all the world. And so they sent a bunch of files. A bunch of files came back and they uploaded the website. And then I arrived. And let's see the website. And guess what? The one I liked the most was, there is not in Portuguese a word for match. There's not. Matching, which is quite a simple word, right? But we don't have the similar in Portuguese. But to make things more complicated, what else match or matches mean in English? What else? Who can give me?
My cigarette smoke.
Matches, right? So I have a bunch of pages translated as phosphorus. Matches. Welcome. You just got your first match. You just got your first phosphorus. And it really looks like a joke, doesn't it? But it was real. I had the managing director of a whole operation just reviewing text because it was wrong. And if that was wrong, imagine when you had the brand lines, when you had the inspirational texts, everything was really in a mess and we had to retranslate everything, localizing obviously to Brazilian Portuguese, which is obviously different. So then the website goes live. I came back to Brazil. I went back to Brazil and started hiring everything. So agencies, suppliers, office, hiring people. And in November, we went to our first TV campaign. So here, another hurdle. And I'll just jump a few slides because I think it's worth showing to you guys. Where is it? Oh, here it is. So, hey Stanlei, very simple. We have a TVC, a TV commercial, ready to go because we just did it in England. Why don't you pick this and do some voiceover and put in Brazil? I said, great, let's do that. It costs $150,000 just for you to air as taxes, for you to air a TVC that is not made in Brazil. Not production costs, not media, just tax, protectionist tax, because it was made outside of Brazil. So instantly my P&L was a red, even with more losses, right? Because it was November and then we had to do that. But even worse than that, imagine that the TVC was filmed here in the US with a bunch of Americans and some English people. And some of them really didn't look like Brazilians. I mean, really didn't look like Brazilians. So, but hopefully they did with 100 couples, right? This eHarmony has this tradition of only doing TVCs with real couples. So it's people that met at eHarmony and married at eHarmony and had kids at eHarmony, and they go and for free they just cut our costs a lot by free advertising for eHarmony. So what we did, we spent some time screening all the 100 couples to find the ones that would look like a bit more like Brazilians. And so we came up with these guys. Not the blondes, light eyes or blue eyes or green eyes, right? We need some people with dark hair or darker as possible. And so we came up with some of them, and then we had to, in order to cut the tax costs, there comes the second thing about Brazil. Brazil is very bureaucratic. We have a law system that is, unlike here in the UK, it's not based on past sentences. It's based on the law. So if a judge interprets the law different from another judge, he can do it, basically, right? So you don't have, if one decision was made in the past, in the future, they can be made different depending on the judge. So, remember I told you, $150,000 just a tax, right? Per TVC. But if we took the footage and hired a Brazilian guy to do the editing and hire a Brazilian guy to speak and do a voiceover and finalize it in Brazil, the tax would fall to 20,000, which is the same movie, right? I just re-edited. So we did that, saved some money, had a unique TVC editing with the people that we chose, and then we went live. What happened when we went live? Here is another very interesting thing. Because in Brazil, media agencies are not allowed to operate. The only way you can buy media in Brazil is if you are a creative agency. So, and why is that? Because of this. TV, and here is Open TV, right? Open TV. Does Open TV make sense for you guys? It's like from the antennas, right? Nobody has to pay for it. How do you call that here in the US?
Broadcast.
Broadcast TV, yes. So broadcast TV accounts for 66% of all advertising money in Brazil. Why is that? Because every night we have a Super Bowl on Globo, which is the largest TV broadcasting in Brazil. Every night we have a soap opera that's very famous, right? Which obviously keeps changing from time to time. It's not the same soap opera for forever, but it's the soap opera time. And that time, close to 80 million people watch TV at the same time. So it's a huge number every day watching the same channel. So that's why all the money goes to one, most of the money goes to only one medium, and within that medium, only one player. And they create some barriers. So the only thing that they don't want is for a media agency to come in, buy in wholesale, and resell in retail. So this is forbidden in Brazil. How they did it, they created a law that only creative agencies could buy media. And so I end up with some very crappy media agencies in Brazil. Actually, I have a media department inside a creative agency, like Ogilvy. So Ogilvy is a creative agency. In Brazil, it's the only place where Ogilvy buys TV. Okay? What's the impact for that? The impact is that eHarmony, as many internet-based companies, rely and depend on direct response TV. What's that? It's buy TV in a way that brings traffic on the cheapest way as possible, right? In Brazil, I can only buy TV for branding or in a more branding way. So what we had to do? We had to develop the agency that we chose to think like you wanted them to think. And they created a whole department only to buy media for us in a way that make them really, really not happy with us. Because basically, they would make much less money and work much more than with any other client. But that was the only way to do it. So going back to our timeline, went to Brazil, and here, second challenge, let's make payments, right? So put the website up and put a paywall and let's charge people credit cards. At the time, Brazil was going through a demonopolization of the credit card structure. So Visa was up until this date, and I was very lucky because a few months later, I wouldn't have that problem, but up until this date, Visa would only pass, only swipe on Visa machines. And MasterCard would only swipe on MasterCard machines. And American Express only on American Express machines, and you get the idea. So typically in a gas station, you'd have a table like this with 10 different machines where you would say, oh, my Visa, MasterCard, and this Visa, okay. And then I would pass on Visa. So we were going through the demonopolization. So what happened? I put the paywall live. I had to choose one to start to integrate. So I went, eHarmony went up live. The paywall went live with only accepting Visa and nothing else. Well, not nothing else, because things are more complicated than that. Brazil also has a law that says that if you sell anything to anyone, you have to accept cash. It's simple. Someone goes into your store, he wants to buy, he wants to pay with cash, you have to accept the cash, right? Obviously, they didn't think about the internet when the law was made some decades ago. So we had a offline manual operation where we would receive cash from customers who would want to send us cash. And guess what? What do you think consumers did? Some of them.
Wanted to pay with cash.
Wanted to pay with cash on online internet, and they want to send us cash. So actually, it was close to 10% of sales was cash-based. Until we were able to put MasterCard live and a very particular thing, which we call the boleto. Has anyone heard about that? You have. You have suffered with it. So the boleto is a very traditional payment method, which basically it's a bill you issue and go to the bank and you can pay it, right? And so when we put that on our website, so people could issue their own boletos, then we are complying with the law because the guy would issue, go to the bank, and can pay cash. Not to us, but he can pay cash. And just so you can see, this is how payment methods were divided by then. Visa and MasterCard had 71% of the market, right? If I added a bunch of other brands here, it would go up to 82%. If I end direct debit through bank account, right, paying with our bank account, would go up to 89%. This whole thing would account to 92%. And boletos represented 16% of all my sales. So they were relevant. Imagine having 16 or sometimes 20. When you put alive, it was 20. 20% of our sales online depends on a payment method that does not exist anywhere. Not here, right? So those, obviously, I'm just going through with them. But those challenges were very difficult. And my last slide tells, and I'll just leave the suspense for now, what is the most difficult thing all those things caused to me. We'll get there. So, Money Guru spent 2 years with eHarmony, just to tell you briefly the story. Spent two years with eHarmony. I set up the company. We had over 1 million users, paying users, for just after the first year of operation, revenue in the range of millions. So it was a very successful setup with lots of barriers, right? And the main barrier is what is in my last slides, which I'll show you when you get there. So I'm happy at eHarmony, and this guy comes in and asks to have a talk with me. A friend of mine from eHarmony, actually, from eHarmony UK, left eHarmony and said, look, Stan, I have an investor who wants to do something in Brazil. Would you receive him? And then I said, oh, yeah, sure, bring him in. So they came from the UK. Me and my marketing director, we went to have a dinner with them. It was a really fantastic dinner, 8 to 1 a.m. We had a lot of fun, drank a lot. We really like to party, as you've seen in the TV, in the movie, in the video. So I went back home, and when we arrived at the restaurant, I asked my marketing director, did you do a backup check on him? You know who this guy is? Oh, no, he didn't. Me neither. Okay, let's go. Fun. Next day, I arrive at the office. My marketing director comes and says, Stanley, you don't believe it. You know who we had dinner last night? I said, who? The cousin of the Queen of England. So I just spent a lot of hours saying a lot of nonsense bullshit to the cousin of the Queen of England. So first lesson is, do your homework, okay? When you go meet somebody, do your homework. We have LinkedIn for that, right? And Google, so simple. So basically, we really connected really well, maybe because I didn't know who he was. So don't do the homework and go blindly to your meeting with investors. Maybe it's better. And he invited me to join as a partner and as the CEO of the company. And so again, I left eHarmony, empty-handed again, and from scratch started yet another company, which is Money Guru. Why he chose Brazil to start a money a financial intermediation company? Because of this. This goes from 2000 to 2012, okay? You have on the bars, you have profitability, and the lines you have margin or spread, okay? So, as you've seen, UK, Europe as a whole, has been through a serious threat to their profitability because the cost has improved a lot, right? So they have a drop in profitability, so they need to have better intermediation processes. Brazil has the highest spread, banking spread, in the world in 2012. So we're talking about a spread of 4.5 points of spread on average on everything, while in the more developed world is around 1, in the US around 2.5, right? And on profit, we only lose to Russia, which I'm sure it's short-lived, right? Especially given what's going on in Russia. But so think about it. The banks have all this profit. So what they do, as everyone has always done in the world, they share with the guys who are in between, right? So he can sell more and push more products down the consumers. So it's a very profitable business in Brazil right now, being in financial intermediation, because you have really high margins. Let me give you an example. If I sell to you a loan, you want a loan, right? You want, let's say, $5,000. You need $5,000, you pay that in 12 months, and you get the loan. And I am a bank representative, okay? And I am able to sell to you this loan. So you got how much? $5,000, right? I can make 20% of the $5,000. 20%. Why is that? Because she's going to pay close to 40, 50, 60% a year on interest rates. Wow. Sometimes, she said, no, I won't borrow money with you. I will borrow with my credit card, right? I have a credit, so I will use my credit card. 11% per month. 11% per month. If you don't pay your credit card bill on time, they will charge you 11% per month. But if you're a really good customer, who obviously does not need credit because you have a lot of money, then they reduce it to 7 per month. So lots of margin here, which brings a very particular, let's talk about credit card very quickly. A whole different dynamic. Credit cards are not credit, they are cards in Brazil. So credit cards in Brazil are not credits, they are cards. What I mean? I use credit cards a lot. I have 6 or 7 credit cards. I have never used the credit. I just use them to swipe as a payment method. When my bill arrives, I just paid the whole bill. So they are more a payment method than a way for you to get credit to finance your things. Okay? So, and what's Money Guru? Well, Money Guru has a very interesting challenge to become the money guru or the bank rate, which is the equivalent US website of Brazil. So what size are those companies? Is it worth to keep doing this? Well, Money Supermarket is evaluated, has market cap, is on the UK stock exchange, £1.7 billion, while bank rate is $1.4 billion. So they are evaluated, there are billion-dollar companies, so it's worth trying to do it. Especially because Brazil economy is the same size as the UK and 23% bigger than Canada, right? As I shown before. So, whoa, there's a lot of money to be made here. Literally a lot of money. And how are we supposed to do that? Brazil is a very intermediate intensive country. So brokers are everywhere. And then another very particular thing. Brokers are insurance companies cannot sell directly to consumers because it's against the law. It's not against the law per se. But if you do it, you have a lot of taxes, blah, 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 so it's worth not doing, right? That's the way. It's not against the law, but it's how you make things happen. So basically, no insurer that you know sell directly. They all sell through brokers. So people in Brazil are very used to have brokers selling to them. Why is that? Remember that 50% of the population is really poor. So I have a lot of people to pay very little to have them working for me, okay? So what values Money Guru will bring to Brazil? First, consumers, access to several suppliers in one place. Yesterday, I arrived here in the US, today is Saturday? Yes, yesterday, yes, I did arrive yesterday. And me and my wife, and we went to T-Mobile, to get a SIM card for our cell phone, right? Have you done that before? Yes? I entered. I want a SIM card. How much? Oh, how long are you going to stay? 1 week. Okay, 1 week, I have three per day, $21. Here it is. 10 minutes, right? I'm out of the store with my SIM card, putting the cell phone, works. My friend, the Lord, tried to get a prepaid SIM card in Brazil for his cell phone. With my help. It took 2 hours. The same process. 2 hours. Everything in Brazil is very slow, bureaucratic, red-taped, and when you try to do something different, like getting with a gringo to buy a prepaid card who does not have a Brazilian address, that's it. You know, you just can't get out of the other side without a lot of effort. So we will add value to consumers by making things easy. We will add value to suppliers by properly matching the users to their products. Because the users do not understand what they're asking for. And so the guy who does not have credit asks for a platinum credit card and gets denied. If he asks for a regular credit card or even a prepaid card, he may get his card. Right? And he does not want the credit. He just wants the card. So we are helping the banks to properly match users with the products they have. And we also add value to intermediaries, because the intermediaries are not going to disappear from Brazil. When first the Lord came to me, he said, we are going to make a revolution in Brazil, like I did in UK. And to his credit, he really did. He created U-Switch. I didn't tell that story, but my George, which is my partner, created in 2000 a website in the UK called U-Switch, together with Money Supermarket. The difference is he sold in 2006 by £200 million, which is a fair amount of money. I usually say that he no longer needs to steal to survive, right? And he owned more than 50% of it, so he made quite some good money. And he wants to do everything in Brazil again. And he said, the intermediary disappeared in the UK. And I said, they will not in Brazil. It's going to take too long. I mean, decades. So, we will not do the same thing. We will do it differently. We will sell what we can directly, but we will also sell the information we have to other offline intermediaries like ourselves, and even some competitors. Because in this way, we can help monetize our business and do not fight the system, but use the system to our benefit. I think this is the key thing here. And I'm sure it's the same thing to any other different country. Instead of fighting the country or the status quo, the smart manager will understand the status quo and work with it to make more money, right? So this is what we're doing here. We are adapting in order to surf the wave of the market. And how are we? So company founded March 2013, and by founded I mean we were in Rio drinking a lot of caipirinhas, and we kind of signed something, you know? I'm positive it was a good contract, but it was with a lot of caipirinhas. Do you know what caipirinhas are?
Yes.
Ah, so Brazil you have never been, but caipirinhas you know. Okay. So, we signed here. I start putting together the company. We launched the first alpha site with a different name, which has the M and the G, but means my money, my cash, my money. Then we had health insurance, flights, proper money guru brands, community, offline sales team. So we are an online company with an offline sales team, which means a call center. I have lots of people in boats much smaller than these ones that you are right now, with less space, selling a bunch of our financial products to consumers who go online, leave their data, even pay to through the internet. Very few, but even some pay. But they still need to have someone talk to them for them to not give up or to actually convert them. Financing, which is a consortium. I'll explain. Consortium. Brazil also has a bunch of very specific financial products that only exist in Brazil. For instance, consortium is one of them. So, remember, you want to buy your car, right? What's your name?
Chuba.
So, you want to buy your car. And you go to a car dealer, and he says, I have a really good deal for you. For you only, it's going to be 15% a year on interest rates. Okay? 15% is not that much, right? And you say, but 15%, I'll pay this in 5 years. And you buy a car in 5 years of 15% a year. Do your math, right? Double or more. And isn't there another way to buy it, to do it? Yes. People came up with consortium. What is consortium? Let's say the 20 of us here, 20 of us, get together and say, let's buy a car. Yes. So I can pay 1/20th of a car. So let's say the car costs 20,000 reais. Each one can give 1,000 per month. So what we do? Everyone comes on month one, put 1,000 into a pot. And then we draw a lucky one who will get the pot. So in the first month, you are not drawn. You are. And you didn't even want the car. She convinced you to come into the thing, you know? Because she needs another person to fulfill the quota. But you get all the money and goes and buy your car. Next month, you have to continue pay. Everyone puts again. And then you draw another number. Obviously, you can no longer be drawn, right? And so on and so forth. It's a consortium of people to buy something, right? This became so famous that the Central Bank of Brazil transformed this into a regulated product. And one product that we make a lot of money selling because it has high commissions also. Okay? So imagine you're buying a car or a house. I can have 5% or 6% of the value if I just convince you to join. So here comes another very important point, which was the acquisition of Capitalis. And Alice, please tell me when I have to stop. Okay. Like I said, Brazilians like to talk, right? So we made a bunch of decisions on setting up Money Guru. When we first started, we say we're going to do car insurance. That was the European-American model. And then we discovered that car insurance was really complicated. There was a bunch of players there, online players, trying to do it. So what we did? Let's wait, let's go broad, and at some point, we'll be able to acquire people, okay? So that's one of the acquisitions we made, which was Capitalis, which was a very good player who had shareholder problems, right? They had a very huge user base of almost 1 million users, with a lot of SEO-based websites. And we acquired them. And together, we acquired also a whole new vertical as personal loans. And now we are probably on our way to do further acquisitions. One of them is going to be car insurance for another player. So this was another very important decision in our business. Although we wanted to start in one way. We properly understood the market, did not rush, and set up some goals that we need to do. So we need to have this vertical, so we need to do an acquisition. And what we did? Worked a lot, trying to talk to everyone in the market, to know them, to make a decision of which ones were good to do the acquisition. Okay? Challenges. Well, one of them I already told you, which is Media agencies are not allowed in Brazil. Advertising share is very complicated. Target internet is, this is medium divided by social class, okay? Socioeconomic class. A is the guys who have more money. E absolutely live in misery. I mean, literally misery. They make 10 bucks per week, if that much. So, internet has a bunch of people who is poor because of the efforts of the government to make digital inclusion, right? So pay TV, or cable TV, I think it's the term here, right? It's more qualified. I have more A and B's than internet. So actually, to sell online, I need to advertise offline and bring more qualified people to the internet. So obviously, the internet itself is a challenge. So other challenges. And here, I think it's the slide I told you about, the most difficult challenge about doing things in Brazil. Well, bureaucracy, I told you. Labor costs, ooh. Oops. Why are you laughing, Simon? You should be crying.
I should be crying.
So I have 40 or 50 employees. I will pay, I talk to my employee and say, how much you want to make? And make an offer to him. You're going to make, I will pay you 10,000 reais per month. Okay? 10,000 reais per month. Which is a quite a good salary, $5,000 or something. Out of the 10,000, the guy keeps 7,000. I pay 20,000 on taxes. So basically, the company spends 20,000 and the employee only sees 7,000 of the money. It's absurdly absurd. It's labor costs are really a big issue now in Brazil. So this also shifts the balance a lot when you're talking with making models, for instance, right? The models here in the US to go to Brazil do not work. You need to make much more profit in order to be profitable, or much more revenue to be profitable, right? Team hunting. Brazil is really growing. We have, right now, the lowest unemployment rate ever in recorded history. So, not only employees are very expensive, but they are scarce. Which obviously is very good to Brazilians, very good to me, because they have to pay a lot to keep me in the company. But it's very hard to hire people, very hard. Especially in high demand jobs like internet technology, you know, same thing as everywhere in the world, but with high costs. And I think now, yes, the toughest thing of all is try to explain that all to gringos. I'm not joking. The 2 years and a half that I spent in eHarmony, 20 to 25% of my time was explaining things to gringos. Explaining that to them that there is 10 machines to pay for this. Nah, you are kidding me. You can't pay. I'm not kidding you. Worse. You know, the TVC to run in Brazil has a 150,000 fine. No. Please, call the lawyers. I'm telling you. No, I want the lawyers to see. So go. And which lawyer an American company will hire in Brazil? the most expensive possible, right? So they spent fortunes on lawyers, and after maybe the 10th or 11th time that the lawyer said the same thing I did, they started to hire a cheaper lawyer to verify what I was saying. But eventually, they let me hire the lawyer. So it's very hard because things like going to the gas station and filling your tank, you take for granted. In Brazil, it's not. And many other countries in the world, by the way. Right? Things really are different. And I hope to have given you some examples of very specific things that you would never think would be a challenge for a company starting up, right? Because on top of everything, there's still the usual challenges of any company, right? It's not easy to make a company run. So all the challenges of a regular company here in the US or in more developed countries remain the same. We need to attract consumers, we need to attract them cheaply, we need to make them convert, we need to properly scale. Everything is there, plus a bunch of other stuff, plus a bunch of gringos saying that you're doing the wrong thing. Thank you. So, please, ask away. What do you have? Yeah.
I was wondering why eHarmony chose the Brazilian market to enter, if they didn't really have the understanding, they didn't really have the staff on board. Why was it this market of 200 million people that they chose?
Greedy.
They thought it would be...
Yeah, well, greed.
Yeah.
So they, check it out, they went to UK, Australia, and Canada, right? Ooh. English-speaking countries, it's over, right? So let's go to Europe. A bunch of languages, very small countries. Oh, that's going to be very troublesome. And especially in a product that's language-based, it's relationship, right? People need to talk to each other. They can't talk German, so you need to translate. You really need to have different languages. And what is the biggest country who speaks a single language? There's Russia, right? Americans love to build business in Russia. There's China. Then there's Brazil. Ooh, Brazil looks good, isn't it? And the marketing director was not very happy on his marriage. So, you know, Brazil, yeah, mulatas, caipirinhas. No, seriously. Because of size, because of internet penetration, it's a UK worth of internet people. Time spent online. People really spend time online for a relationship website. Really good. We really are number one in terms of time spent online in the world. Those were the main reasons. And the marriage, what's on there. So, what else? Yep?
It's a little off topic. So you said that the credit cards function differently over there. What does someone use to build their credit then? What's the nominal charge to, you know, your first credit card?
How do you say when you have money in your checking account?
Yeah.
Overdraft?
Yeah.
Overdraft would be the first credit product of most Brazilians.
So paying an overdraft back?
Yeah, you gain the ability of draft more money from your bank account than you have on it, right? Okay. Is that called overdraft?
Overdraft.
Overdraft, right? So basically that's when you open a checking account, you don't have overdraft.
Right.
If you don't have money, you don't have money. Then as time goes by, you end up getting the credit that allows you to borrow money from a bank. Okay? But just to make sure you got it, the credit cards work exactly like elsewhere in the world.
Right.
What doesn't work is how people use them. Okay? They don't use them for credit. They use them for, as a payment method. Any more questions? Yes?
I was just wondering what the, because we're talking about venture capitalism, what does like the VC scene look like in Brazil? Did you have like outside investors helping along the way, offering you additional funding? And then beyond that, what kind of partnerships did you look for strategically? Was it like mostly like through friends that you had known working on other projects? And then maybe just speak to that a little bit.
Yeah, sure. So there are some local VC. We have a similar structure in country as you have here, for instance. Okay, you have angels, you have first round VCs, private equity, the whole thing, but in a much less developed way. I would say in a much less developed way, especially venture capital. You have angels. You even have growth or private equity, but the middle, the VCs, is really lacking in Brazil, because it's when you need to put some considerable amount of money with a large risk. And why is that? Because if I do nothing, so I have a lot of money. I have 1 million, who I could put in a startup, or I could put in the bank. How much if I put in the bank will give back to me in 1 year? How much? Who guess from the rates I was talking here?
15%.
12%, 15%. I have some money on the bank, who that month on a risk-free investment, fixed income. It's not stocks, right? Fixed interest rates. I got 1.05% last month. In a fund that has not much money. So for an investor to get out of the bed and say, I put money in here, it needs to be worth 12% plus risk. So you really need to have you really need to convince them to put the money. So that's the local scenario. Then the external scenario, you do have some players who put money in Brazil, but they are also limited, right? Because then it's people in the US or in Europe who have to choose. And some of them say, well, I'll do something in Brazil, and that's it, right? I'll keep doing US, Europe, Asia. So again, it's limited. So we have the same structure, but with much less players and much harder. Does that make sense?
Yeah, that's
good. Yes?
As a venture capitalist here, I wonder if you can speak about your own funding strategy. Presumably at eHarmony, it was all funded by eHarmony. What about Money Guru? Maybe you could speak about that.
Yeah, sure. So we were quite lucky because we have the Lord, right? So basically he said, look, I have X amount of money in the order of millions of pounds for us to start the business. How much do you think you're going to need to make it happen? Well, 5-6 times that, I replied to him, right? After business plans and everything. So he said, okay, let me start with 1/5, 1/4, 1/6 of this amount, and let's make it happen so you can start going after money, right? And that's one of the reasons I'm here, also in California, because we are doing a roadshow to investors. We just did a roadshow to in UK, and I think one experience that I didn't have was the friends and family experience, which can be really powerful, really powerful. We raised more than £2 million with friends and family, granted, it was a very particular friends and family from a very particular person. But those persons are out there, right? Bunch of investors. So it's much easier to get money from people who are friends, from someone who already is investing in the business, than to go and look money on a cold call, right? It can happen, it happens, but it's much easier when you get one of the main investors to go, now, you are in it. Now bring people that you believe can bring money and get in. And his friends and family are not putting that much money, putting 100, 200, 300 of pounds, but still, it was a much easier process than going through the traditional roadshow and funds who have thousands of things on their minds, and then there's one more kicking around. So I think this was a very, very interesting experience. On the other side, it was much more personal. So he would ask questions, instead of asking questions about financials, he would ask questions about my personal life and about me. You know, like, in other words, what he was thinking was, are you trustworthy of me putting my money in you, right? And the number is okay, the number is, we'll sort it out. So that was a very interesting experience. And now I'm doing the roadshow with the big guys, so maybe in a few months I can come back here and tell you what really happened. Anything else you want to make?
Another thing that would be interesting is when you described the salaries in Brazil, and you said the person who received 700, the company's paying 2,700 goes to him. Does a large part of that go like for a pension fund for him, for health insurance for him? How much of it indirectly goes to him, and how much of it?
This is very interesting. Brazil ends up being a very I'm not sure if I know this word in English. It is paternizing. Does that make sense, right? So Brazil takes care of its people in a sick way. So we give poor people meal vouchers. We give them milk vouchers. We give them health vouchers. We give them whatever it is vouchers. We give them pension vouchers, which is on a compulsory way, every time I pay someone, 8% I need to put in a bank account of the government that the employee cannot retrieve, can only retrieve when he retires. Right? And obviously, this money is on a very low interest rate remuneration. So the government makes a lot of money out of it, right? So the money goes back to the employee, but takes time and takes value from it, right?
What percentage would you say?
I would say it's another 20%.
So it becomes, the 70 becomes 90?
90, yeah. Yeah.
And then 110 is still just pure taxes going to the government?
Pure taxes, bureaucracies, well, yeah, yeah, yeah.
That's amazing. Wow, that's high. That's the highest I've ever heard.
It's really high. It's really high. It's amazingly high. And that's, and to make things worse, if you try to circumvent this law, legal system in Brazil does not work, right? At all. It takes ages for you to sue anybody. We don't have the sue industry. Except for labor. So everything is done for the companies to fail, you see? So the only thing that really works is labor law, almost instantly. If I'm an employee, and I go and sue at the company, in 2 or 3 months, the guy can sue, I'll give you an example. If I don't pay all those taxes, right? A guy who makes 10,000 reais per month, and I have him with me for 2 years. So 10,000, 2 years gives 240, right? He can sue me for over 2 million. 2 million. And sometimes the judge makes me pay 1 million or half that. If I don't pay everything according to the law, right? So a lot of people do not pay everything according to the law and run the risk of being sued, which is another point that really devaluates companies when Americans, typically American company wants to buy Brazilian company. American company hire the more expensive lawyer in Brazil. The more expensive lawyer, the most expensive lawyer goes and do a due diligence and said, oh, I found employees who are not legally registered. So, discount the value of the company by X tens of millions because it's a real liability. And to make things worse, I, as a partner of the company, if the company does not pay, the judge on his computer, on the day that we are there, he can freeze all my bank accounts and assets personally because my company did not pay the employee. Limited liability company, which is MoneyGuru, is MoneyGuru Limitada. Limited liability company really does not exist. It goes to my personal assets if something like that happens. And to make things more fun, you cannot open a company in Brazil without a Brazilian residence. So you can't, you just can't. You can't go and open a company. You need a Brazilian resident. Does not need to be a Brazilian, but needs to be a Brazilian resident. Okay? So lots of people makes money, really. Lots of people in Brazil makes $5,000 to $6,000 per month just by signing as representative of a company. There's nothing else. And there are some guys who have like thousands of companies. His job is to keep signing things for bureaucracy. Anything else? More questions? Thank you. I hope you enjoyed. And obviously, now you understand why I gave the video, right? Because when you go to Brazil, you don't need to think about all those things, just the video and the beach.
That was excellent. Thank you. I appreciate it.